worship. If you're having any audio issues today, you can control the volume in the left-hand corner of the screen. I hope that you'll jump on the chat and let us know that you are here. And share this with your family and friends, because we are all in this together. And then go to peacelutheran.com, where you can pick up the bulletin and see what else is going on. Throughout the service today, we are going to be slowly dimming the lights in the sanctuary as we tell the story of Jesus' death. And we invite you to be part of that same experience by turning the lights on brightly now and then slowly dimming them in your own home throughout the service as well. Thanks for joining us. Let's go worship together. Welcome to worship. It is good to be together today on this Good Friday as we join Christians around the world, as we come together to hear the story of Jesus' crucifixion and burial. As we come this day, there are a few things that we would like you to know.
Now let me make you aware of some opportunities coming up. First and foremost is an invitation to join us online for our Easter worship. Our worship times are Saturday evening, 5:30 and 7:05, and then again on Sunday morning at 7 o'clock, 8:15, 9:45, and 11 a.m. Hope that you can make it to worship and plug into a great sound system so we can fill your house with awesome music. For all the information, just go to peacelutheran.com/Easter. And have all that information at your fingertips. For all of those of you who are doing Holy Week peep dioramas creations, we want you to share your creation with us on Facebook. So snap a shot and send it in so we can see what you have done. And then I want to invite you to bring the Word of God into your life every day by subscribing to Daily Bread Devotions written by your own peace pastors. Simply go to peacelutheran.com/devotions and become a subscriber, and we'll email you a devotion daily. And then join us on a dove hunt. You are aware of the teddy bear hunt that's going on, craze that's going on in Facebook. So we're going to have a peace dove hunt as a way of putting doves in our windows so that as you walk through your neighborhood, you will be aware of other peace members that are near you, and that you can say your prayer for one another. So what I want you to do is go to peacelutheran.com/children's to find the dove design, print it out, color it, cut it out, and then post it in the window. And then, as you go on your own dove hunt, report to us how many doves you've located. And as always, to stay up to date in this ever-changing ministry that we are part of, invite you to go to peacelutheran.com/updates or to our home webpage and hit the updates button at the top of the page so you can be up to date with what's going on at the Ministry of Peace Lutheran.
Indeed, mission and ministry continues around here in new and creative ways. It is good to be together in this. And of course, your tithes and offerings are ways that you continue to worship and support what is going on.
Worship and first of all offer up an offering of thanksgiving for those in our community who are working hard to keep us safe, for our health workers who are on the front lines, for our grocery clerks and workers who are providing food for us, for the restaurants who are still serving food. A big thanks for all the ways that God is providing for us through all those people, and a special thanks how God is providing for each of us through our ministry that we share together here at Peace Lutheran. Not only the church staff, but each of you have taken it upon yourselves to reach out and connect with one another so that in this time of isolation, we do not have to feel the despair and hopelessness that comes with feeling alone, that we can beat back the fear by remembering that Christ is with us and is making himself known in the presence and words of each other. So thank you for your part in this ministry. And as always, thank you for your financial support that keeps this ministry organized and focused as we go through this time of pandemic. Thank you.
Please join me as together we pray our prayer of the day. Almighty God, look with loving mercy on your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed, to be given over to the hands of sinners, and to suffer death on the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Now it's time for the children's message, as we get to welcome all you little ones with us today, and of course, my special friends I have. My special friends I have with me today, Jack and Jill. How are you guys doing today? I'm so happy to see you.
I'm so great. It's a 4-day weekend.
Oh, I bet you are excited. My kids have a 4-day weekend as well, and I tell you what, I have never been so excited as my kids having 4 days off from homework. Jill, how are you today? You look a little different. Did you do something different with your hair?
Well, no, nothing different with my hair.
Maybe it's that mask you're wearing.
Yeah, it's new. I'm wearing it because of the virus.
Oh. Okay. I heard some doctors saying that it would be a good idea to wear a mask if you go out in public. I'm glad to see that you're trying to be safe.
Well, that's not why I'm wearing the mask.
Oh, that's not why you're wearing it. Then why are you?
I'm wearing it because I'm scared and I don't want anyone to see.
You're scared? Huh. I'm never scared of anything.
Well, Jack, it's okay to be scared or worried or sad. Or really, however you feel, it's okay. We don't need to be ashamed or to hide how we feel. In fact, Jill, I am so glad that you shared with me that today, because that gives us an opportunity to talk about it. And I hope that every boy and girl has a loving adult in which they can share all of their feelings with. Can you say more about why you're scared?
Everything is different. I miss my friends. It's still cold and snowing, and it's about to be Easter. My birthday is soon. My brother won't leave me alone. I haven't hugged Pastor Paul in a month. My parents are teaching me math completely different from my teacher. I just don't understand.
Wow, Jill, that sounds like you have a lot going on. And I wish I could give you some answers that would make you feel all better. But really, I don't understand everything either. It's just hard, isn't it?
Now that you say it, I think I'm afraid of some of those same things.
Well, thanks, Jack, for sharing that as well. It really helps to know that we're all in this together and that we're not alone when we feel sad. You know, this kind of reminds me a little bit of Peter.
One of Jesus' friends, the disciple Peter?
That's right, Peter, who was one of Jesus' best friends. He gets a little scared in our Bible story today. He doesn't understand everything that's happening. And when Jesus is arrested, 3 times when he asks if he knows Jesus, he lies and says that he doesn't know who he is. Peter was scared. And while he didn't want to let his friend down, he also didn't know how to help either. And that made him hide, even from Jesus.
Was Jesus mad?
Well, we don't get to the ending of that part of the story tonight. But no, Jesus wasn't mad. In fact, Jesus went out of his way to go find Peter and tell him just how much he loves him. And that's what Jesus wants from most from us when we're scared, to talk with him. And do you know how we talk with Jesus?
Well, they talk about prayer in Sunday school a lot.
That's right. Jesus wants us to pray and to talk with him. Of course, we should talk to other adults too, but I have always found that when I talk to Jesus, it helps a lot.
Can we pray now?
Sure, of course we can. Let us pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for being with us. Thank you for always being around to talk with and to listen to what makes us afraid. Help us to feel your love, so even when we don't understand, we can at least remember all of the ways that you help us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thanks, Pastor Jonathan.
Yeah, thanks. I don't feel so afraid now, but I'm still going to wear the mask because it brings out the color of my eyes.
Well, I think that's a great idea. And thanks for praying with me. I feel better too. And I think it's time now to say goodbye to all of our friends out there. Bye.
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 John, the 18th chapter. After Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who had betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees. And they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was about to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." A Judas who betrayed him was standing with him. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these things go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword and drew it, struck the high priest's slave and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back in its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?"
their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First, they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, "You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. And Jesus answered, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said." When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Then Annas sent him, bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, "You are not also one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Again, Peter denied it, and at that moment, the cock crowed.
Oh, sacred and They took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law." The Jews replied, "We are not permitted to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus and asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, "I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the King of the Jews?" They shouted in reply, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a bandit.
Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him. So Jesus came out wearing a crown of thorns and a purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." When the chief priests and police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has claimed to be the Son of God."
Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and the power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him. But the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be king sets himself against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at the place called the stone pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to be crucified.
Thank you.
cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write 'the King of the Jews,' but 'this man said I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written."
Jesus. They took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now, the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the tops. So they said to one another, "Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who'll get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And this is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." And then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there, so they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. And when Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
Thank you.
left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus, they saw that he was already dead. They did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you may also believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled. None of his bones shall be broken. And again, another passage of scripture says, they will look on the one whom they have pierced. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one, because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed the body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to see Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices and linen cloth according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.
Does this really happen? I mean, it can't be. This has all gone too far. No one expected it to go down like this, for Jesus to actually be taken. They came with swords and torches, with what seemed like a whole army to take him by force. Not that it mattered, because he went with them willingly. First to the high priest, then to Pilate, the cross, and finally to the tomb. It all happened so quickly. And the question that keeps going through our mind is, did this really happen? A judgment without justice. Mercy in the form of sour wine. Jesus giving his final words and proclaiming it is finished. And we feel these words so deeply. These last moments of Jesus' life and our own lives as well. Holy Week is the most important week of the year for me. Each and every year, I so love this quest, this spiritual quest that takes place in this one week. From the shouts of Hosanna on Palm Sunday to those calls of Crucify Him on Good Friday. But in all the years that I have walked this path, there has never been a year like this. A year when I have felt like I have prayed with Jesus in the garden that all of this may pass, that our cup we would not have to bear. And prayers that have not been answered the way that I had hoped for. Never have I felt the unrelenting pressure of the world with all of its judgment, as if it's all pressing in on us. We are not prepared. Never has it seemed as if the world as we know it has changed so quickly. Maybe just as the disciples felt as they watched all of this unfold before them. It's as if we are carrying our own cross, the cross of the whole world upon our shoulders, stumbling with each step, straining to keep moving forward. But in this annual walk of faith, I always knew what came next. I always knew how the ending of the story that would be told just a few days later, I knew what was coming. But in hopes of making that joy ever so much joyful, it was always this almost a game that we would pretend that we didn't know how it ended. But this year, the end isn't in sight. And we just keep asking, is this really happening? I mean, it can't be. This has all gone too far. No one expected it to go down like this. And it's tempting to get lost in despair. And maybe our stories from today is just another reminder of all that has gone wrong. Except that Good Friday isn't about getting another reminder of how 2,000 years ago, death won, evil won, hopelessness won, even if only for a moment. No, Good Friday is about remembering all that Jesus has endured. That death, evil, and hopelessness didn't so much as win, as it was about God experiencing all that this world has to offer us. That God knows precisely what we go through at times. That we know that our God understands. Good Friday is the annual reminder that every generation has a moment when it seems as if the world is pressing in. But God has walked this path before. And maybe there is no going back from this moment. At least not entirely. And that's why we gather. Because we sit with Jesus as he prays in the garden. We warm our hands next to Peter as he denies Jesus three times. We join in the voices of the crowd who call for crucifixion. We stand with the women at the foot of the cross as Jesus breathes his last. We gather in fear with the disciples at the upper room, wondering all along, is this really happening? It can't be. This has all gone too far. No one expected it to go down like this, for Jesus to actually be taken. And maybe when it seems like we are just pining for the days of only a month ago, when the world seemed to be normal, we also know, and hearing the story of Jesus' death, his entombment in the dark and cold, that this is the place from which true life comes. That we don't need to tell the part of the story that's all about life yet, that it's okay to sit here outside the sealed tomb, but we also don't have to pretend that we don't know the ending that is coming. Because maybe what we need in this moment most is to remember that God continues to breathe life into the brokenness of our world. generation to generation, from nation to nation, from us now to the saints eternal. God breathes life. And echoing Pastor Chris's message from yesterday, remembering that as we gather, we continue to echo what our forebears in the faith have done since the beginning of the Passover. We remember over and over the times that God has reached out in love and mercy and peace. And remembering all of those times, maybe even as we ask the same question, is all of this really happening? We have different words in which to respond. It may be. But God's love reaches out so far. We should have expected God to walk with us each day. And we expect for Jesus to speak words of life to us once again. We wait for that word in just a couple days as we sit here in the midst of the darkness of this world. We also don't lose hope, having heard from time and time, from generation to generation, the goodness and the love and the peace that God continues to offer. Amen. Almighty eternal God, you have shown your glory to all nations in Jesus Christ. By your Holy Spirit, guide the church and gather it throughout the world. Help it to preserve in faith, proclaim your name, and bring the good news of salvation in Christ to all people. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for Constanza Hagemeyer and Elizabeth Eaton, our bishops, for Renee, Jonathan, Chris, and Paul, our pastors, for all servants of the church, and for all the people of God. Almighty and eternal God, your Spirit guides the church and makes it holy. Strengthen and uphold our bishops, pastors, other ministers, and lay leaders. Keep them in health and safety for the good of the church, and help each of us in our various vocations to do faithfully the work to which you have called us. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray for those preparing for baptism. Almighty and eternal God, you continue to bless the church, increase the faith and understanding of those preparing for baptism, give them new birth as your children, and keep them in the faith and communion of your holy church. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Let us pray for our siblings who share our faith in Jesus Christ. Almighty and eternal God, you give your church unity. Look with favor on all who follow Jesus, your Son. Make all the baptized one in the fullness of faith, and keep us united in the fellowship of love. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for the Jewish people, the first to hear the word of God. Almighty and eternal God, long ago you gave your promise to Abraham and your prayers that the people you called and elected as your own may receive the fulfillment of the covenant's promises. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for those who do not share our faith in Jesus Christ. Almighty and eternal God, gather into your embrace all those who call out to you under different names. Bring an end to interreligious strife, and make us more faithful witnesses of the love made known to us in your Son. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for those who do not believe in God. Almighty and eternal God, you created humanity so that all may long to know you and find peace in you. Grant that all may recognize the signs of your love and grace in the world and in the lives of Christians, and gladly acknowledge you as the one true God. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us pray for God's creation. Almighty and eternal God, you are the creator of the magnificent universe. Hold all the worlds in your arms of your care and bring all things to fulfillment in you. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for those who serve in public office. Almighty and eternal God, you are the champion of the poor and oppressed. In your goodness, give wisdom to those in authority, so that all people may enjoy justice, peace, freedom, and to share in the goodness of your creation. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for those in need. Almighty and eternal God, you give strength to the weary and new courage to those who have lost heart. Heal the sick, comfort the dying, give safety to travelers, free those unjustly deprived of liberty, and deliver your world from falsehood, hunger, and disease. Hear the prayers of all who call on you in any trouble, that they may have the joy of receiving your help in their need. We ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
And finally, let us pray for all those things for which our Lord would have us ask. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Us today. Remember to stay connected at peacelutheran.com and through social media. I hope to see you all for Easter worship.